All right. Hey, guys. How's it going? I'm chatting today with Rishi Kumar, who is running for the U.S. House of Representatives in the 18th Congressional District of California. How are you doing today?
Very good. Stephen, thank you so much for the invitation.
Yeah, thanks. I'm excited to chat. One of the big conversations that's going on nationally right now is like primarying against kind of Democratic incumbents. And you're running against somebody that's been in the House for like 20 or 30 years, I think.
Yes, 28th year. Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Before we jump into like super specific questions, just to get kind of a general feel of things, firstly, where would you put yourself on like the political spectrum? Like, clearly you're running as a Democrat, but I guess like where do you roughly stand in that spectrum? Like, would you consider yourself more extreme progressive, more establishment-esque, or yeah, how would you describe yourself?
So, Stephen, I'm challenging Congresswoman Anna Issue from her left, which is the very first time she's had a challenger like me in the last 28 years. Mm-hmm. And I call myself as a capitalist progressive, and I got some values which are very near and dear to Silicon Valley, but I have my unique flavor of politics, which is not going left or right, but going forward. People-centric politics is what I call it.
Gotcha. What are some of the, well, before I guess getting into specific issues, I saw that you've held a couple seats before in as a councilperson in Saratoga, was it?
Correct, yes.
Why run for Congress? What was the big push that got you to decide that you wanted to run in this election now?
You know, there are lots of broken things in politics I see. And for example, I've seen the track record of Congresswoman Anna Issue. Mm-hmm. And one of the core challenges is with respect to how our politicians play ball with the lobbyists and with the special interest groups. So for example, Congresswoman Anna Issue is the number one recipient of pharma money in United States Congress and has passed legislation that increases the price of healthcare. And Stephen, this is what is wrong with American politics today. You know, our politicians are not responding to the needs of the people. The people's voice are being stifled and we are making some very poor choices. It played out quite apparent during this recent pandemic and now with respect to the whole unrest movement that has happened. So I think we need to bring the attention back to people. We need to solve some big challenges because the very future of America is at stake. And with my understanding of the world of tech, coming from the real world, many years in IBM Cisco, we have that ability and the enthusiasm to get things done in the world of politics, which is also my track record as a city council member in the city of Saratoga in my second term currently. I took on some very big challenges with respect to crime and water and going against a powerful utility company to challenge their water rate increases. Mm-hmm. And that led to my re-election with the most votes in 60 years election history of Saratoga. So we are there for the people, Stephen, and we intend to get a lot of stuff done when we are in Congress.
How do you make the decision in terms of like running for the U.S. House of Representatives as opposed to running for something more local or statewide in terms of like enacting change in certain communities? I'm curious like how you make a decision, what level would you think is the most appropriate for you to run for?
So I think part of the challenge is we have never had a congressional leader from Silicon Valley mm-hmm. that has the tech understanding. So whatever has happened here in Silicon Valley has because of the right type of mindsets, the DNA, the right DNA from all parts of the world that converge here to make magic happen with respect to our innovation economy. Mm-hmm. And I saw the hearing of Sundar Pichai and Mark Zuckerberg, and that was a travesty. You know, our elected leaders did not know what Facebook does. One of them is asking, what's your business model if all you do is you provide a social media platform? I mean, that's a travesty that plays out in America. And that's the reason why we need somebody here in Silicon Valley to have an understanding of the world of tech. Mm-hmm. I believe I would have done a better job with all that examination that was conducted. And that is still spoof videos playing out in YouTube.
Yeah.
So
yeah.
Silicon Valley needs the right type of leaders because this is the 19th largest economy in the world. And we cannot take it for granted because the world is changing. You know, China is beating us in many areas, like, for example, blockchain. So we need to bring it back together. We need to dominate the world with respect to technology. We need to create a thriving economy. Something else that we can do is we have a secret innovation sauce that works like magic over here. How can we take that and seed it in different parts of the United States, for example, West Virginia, Louisiana, or Montana, and create a vibrant economy? and provide them economic opportunities, education, and those are the aspirations I have. And evaluating all the different types of opportunities to take the next leap in terms of addressing the problems, working hard for the people and solving the problems. This seemed like the perfect thing for my type of background. That's the reason why, Stephen, we are running for Congress.
What was the, you mentioned that we have like a secret sauce in Silicon Valley, I guess you're referencing in terms of like technological innovation. When you talk about like ceding that to other states, just like a little bit more specifically, what exactly are you referring to there?
Yep, absolutely. So the secret sauce I referred to, Stephen, is the ecosystem we have, the best of brains, but also pioneers, you know, who set the path for venture capital investment, for the economy that we have here, for essentially making sure that the innovation platform will thrive and survive over many, many decades now. And we are showing path to the rest of the world. How can we take this and seed it in different parts, right? Mm-hmm. So it comes from essentially creating opportunities. Now, if we took some of the jobs that we have here, and instead of sending it overseas, you know, how about looking at other states like West Virginia? Son and daughter of a coal miner in West Virginia, is looking at coal mining as an opportunity. But what if we provide them an opportunity to be part of the tech economy, part of social media, for example? You know, I think our young students who get out of high school have a great understanding of social media. It's an opportunity for us to provide them that vocational education and get them integrated with our tech economy. So those are some ideas that we have, you know.
Yeah, I live in LA and I've spent time in San Francisco. Despite how claustrophobic inducing the cities are, it seems like you run into the circular trap where people want to go to these areas to work in tech because other people are there working in tech, and those people are there working in tech because other people are there working in tech. How do you even get started? Like something in, especially like West Virginia or maybe other states that have like a lot of fossil fuel industries, like how do you get started like these technological enterprises? Are there like any, and I'm not trying to get you like on a specific step-by-step plan, but I'm just curious, like broadly speaking, how do you start to instigate interest in these states for these types of programs?
It's very simple. Mm-hmm. You know, I think as a congressional leader here in Silicon Valley, I'll be working with our tech CEOs, with our tech community to see how we can expand out their offices in different parts of the United States. And then working with the elected leaders there. And so let's take the use case of West Virginia. Mm-hmm. You know, what would likely happen is we are launching out vocational training to create those job opportunities. Now let's focus on social media. You know, I think our young students that graduate from high school are quite capable of understanding how to run the marketing of tech companies, you know, of startups, for example, and how they can launch social media initiatives that will provide the success that a startup needs to have. Mm-hmm. It also comes from education. So I think when we look at a public-private partnership, it can be a phenomenal story, and that will create economic prosperity in states like Louisiana, West Virginia, Montana that we're talking about.
Sure. This is kind of tangentially related to that. Do you have any opinions on, some people call this a race to the bottom, where states are very aggressively competing sometimes to bring some of these tech companies over? The most famous example I can think of is in, I think it was in AOC's district or close by in New York City, where the Amazon headquarters was going to come over, but the state or the city didn't want to drop the tax rate or give them enough preferential treatment to do it. How do you think cities should look to compete, I guess, for companies over without like butchering their own tax code or giving a bunch of concessions to companies? I don't know if you've addressed these issues, thought about these types of things before.
Yeah, you know, I think if you look at Elon Musk, you know, he ended up getting almost like $1 billion from President Obama's administration mm-hmm. to get Tesla started. And that's a phenomenal success story. So there is some value in that. Mm-hmm. But at the same time, you know, I think we need to create a competitive even turf between all these different states in terms of how they are attracting companies and talents. So I think it's very important for us to make sure that we are providing, you know, I think it doesn't mean that every state is competing for the same type of jobs. For example, manufacturing, if you look at Nevada, they were competing with California, and Elon Musk ended up moving a fairly large manufacturing plant to Nevada. Mm-hmm. So I think every state needs to establish their niche, and that way there is no competition, you know. So you could pick and choose, you know, how you want to thrive. And when you don't have to go far, because you can look at examples across the country, across the world, you know, countries that have created a very specific ecosystem of what type of jobs that will thrive in that environment. And that's exactly what each state needs to do to differentiate themselves. You know, that's probably a better way to approach it.
Sure. Okay. One of the big topics that you wanted to talk about is something, obviously, as being a computer guy, is near and dear to my heart. Has to do with the general, like, technological illiteracy of a lot of people in Congress. You referenced the Facebook court or the congressional hearings where people were asking like pretty hilarious questions. I remember back when I was a kid. I don't know if you ever saw the. I don't know if it was interviewing the FCC, the whole internet is a series of tubes thing when they're trying to explain why gambling is legal or something like there's yikes. I guess when I look at things like this and I look at Congress, sometimes it seems to just be a function of age. Like a lot of people are older, but I mean, I know there's a lot of people in their 30s and 40s that don't understand, I guess, tech literacy that much as well. How do you take an issue like tech illiteracy in Congress and make that relevant to, you know, the average American that might be voting on somebody? Like, let's say they have a choice between one congressional candidate and another, and you say, well, hey, I'm technologically literate. How does that filter down into some policy position that like a real American feels like impacts them on a daily basis?
Yeah. Mm-hmm. So interestingly, I saw a tweet by Elon Musk yesterday, and he was calling it how the gerontocracy is out of touch in this country. How the gerontocracy is out of touch in this country. And okay. He's essentially calling out some of our aging elected leaders. Mm-hmm. I mean, Senator Dianne Feinstein is 86 years old, and she had a little spiff with our Sunrise Movement kids, and that's not very healthy for America, you know, to watch that. So I think, you know, when you look at how do we address or how do the voters, would they resonate with this type of issue? And the short answer, Stephen, is no, because, you know, we have gone door to door in this congressional district campaigning for the last, I would say, 15 months. And, you know, it's nobody who brings up tech as an issue, but it is definitely an underlying component. And we folks are looking at the type of issues we have and how elected leaders get impacted. Now, when you look at the pandemic and the social unrest that played out, I think it has highlighted to our voters that it's very, very important and urgent that we elect the right type of leaders who are able to withstand and address these types of large challenges that can come our way. We obviously completely fell flat on our knees with respect to the pandemic, you know, and the social unrest is sort of, it's still happening today as we speak. And we seemingly don't have answers for these yet. Mm-hmm. And that goes back to what, you know, what we are observing, that there are career politicians that have been sitting on their seats for many, many years that may not have the vision. And so I think it's a collective package, Stephen. You know, the technology literacy is definitely a component of what would play out in Silicon Valley. But right now, there are a lot more important and urgent challenges related to, for example, COVID-19.
For sure. Pandemic stuff and riot stuff, because obviously these are the two huge like things on the forefront of our minds right now. Those two issues aside, what do you think are a couple of like big like policy changes or legislative changes or big instruments in the federal government that you would say need to be brought more in line today with like with somebody that's like a little bit more has more aptitude for technology? Like, what are a couple things that like if somebody was more tech focused, we could fix this part of the federal government and it would be like a great benefit to all Americans? Can you think of a few of those? Or?
Yes. Mm-hmm. So let me give you an example.
Yeah.
And there are lots of examples, right? Mm-hmm. Because coming from the world of tech, you know, I have a different lens of how we view the problems. Mm-hmm. So when you look at the stimulus package that was rolled out and how it was supposed to help the mom and pop business owners. And, you know, we held lots of small business webinars with and we invited the business community to participate. And mostly there was confusion. Nobody knew how to apply for the loan. They were wondering why they have to go to the banks to apply for the PPP loans. And then the banks were basically putting them off because they were trying to address the needs of their
large clients. Their,
yeah, exactly, or the larger clients. And this is what is wrong with America. You know, we rolled out a system where it was supposed to help the people. It didn't quite work. So to some extent, you know, I think, so what I would talk about is if I was running the distribution of the money, you know, firstly, you would need to understand it has to be data driven in terms of who needs the most money. You have all the data with the tax filings. You know, why are we asking them to fill all that paperwork? We should create an approach where you are developing a piece of software that will figure out, pull out specific data points from the filings, from the financial filings, and then based upon that, it's figuring out, you know, who to distribute money. You already have the bank accounts. You can smoothen the whole process and make it a lot more efficient. Now, when you look at the economic indicators in terms of what do we need to do, right? When you look at trillions of dollars that we have pumped into the US economy, it's based upon like a guess estimate as to what is needed. You know, nobody has a clear pulse of what needs to happen. And I think some of the money has been misdirected to the top 1% where they got tax breaks. They got money which they really didn't need actually. So that's the other aspect of the problem that somebody like me can address. Because if you are able to build out very specific economic indicators, a dashboard that will help you guide and not based upon like guesswork, but based upon real scientific data. You know, we have a bunch of economists who we consult into, but the imperative is that we have to make it a lot more seamless where we are able to address these types of challenges in a very, very simplistic manner compared to this, you know, running like a chicken with the head cut off, you know, and that should not be how Congress should operate.
Yeah, we've actually talked a lot about the PPP loans, especially because somebody in my position is able to apply for them, even if they're not necessarily as harmed as like a restaurant that is like going out of business or won't be there. This conversation about PPP loans was part of a broader conversation even. And I'm curious what your look is on it. Most people that are further to the left are generally in favor of universality, and they usually oppose like means testing programs. From my personal point of view, I feel like means testing can be incredibly positive because it allocates more funds to where they need to go. I'm curious if you have a thought in regards to like when you shoot for certain federal programs, do you just want them to be more like an Andrew Yang, everybody gets X amount kind of thing, or do you want it to be like a more like highly tiered, poor people get more, and then it like scales up or something, like means tested programs versus universality or universal programs? Do you have like a general thought about that?
Yes, I don't quite agree with universality. You know, I think there are specific tiers in our economic strata that have very specific needs, and we need to make it work for them. You know, so for example, you know, and this is not a good example, but it doesn't make sense to give out $1 million to a pizza shop owner. You know, and you have to give them what they need to get that get their business going. You know, in terms of they have 5 employees and they need to make sure that they don't lay them off. You know, so I think it has to be very prescriptive, based on the specific needs of that business, of that particular vertical, in terms of how that would impact the economy also, you know. So it needs to be well-crafted, not just, you know, a single solution that works for all.
Yeah, awesome. I agree 100%. And I wish more of it was, data-driven in terms of like how it's given out, rather than just filling out a form with how much you pay out every month. And then, yeah, the 2.5 times that.
Absolutely. Mm-hmm. And then when you look at simple things, and I mean, this is the federal government, and the initial SBA site was crashing. I mean, people were trying to log in and it took them quite some time to bring it back together. And the stories that we heard on our podcast gatherings was, you know, I tried out, folks are very tech savvy here. So I tried out this browser and that browser and I would never get a confirmation. Finally, I tried out the Chrome browser and it happened to work and I get a confirmation back, you know, which was like crazy. This is the federal government. Come on, we can do a job much better than that.
Yeah, so actually bringing that up, that leads me to the next question. I'm sure that there are a lot of ways that we would like to innovate in the federal government, whether it's improving the ACA website or giving the ATF, you know, electronic files for guns. How do you get Americans on board with a more technologically integrated federal government when some of the experiences that we have right now with the federal government and technology are so bad? So, like, I'm sure a lot of people, I'm thinking of video games right now, but actually, I'm sure a lot of people have firsthand experience trying to use some of the ACA websites when the health exchanges first came up, and a lot of that was a nightmare. How do you bring Americans on board with like more technology from the federal government when their go-to is going to be, I don't want the government doing any of this stuff because they're just going to mess it up like they have things in the past? Like, how do you overcome that hurdle?
And you know, Stephen, it's a pretty simple answer, because when I saw the debacle play out with the PPP loans and the SBA loans, you know, I said, this is a very simple fix. Why don't the federal government collaborate with the private sector? You know, work with one of the tech companies and have them build that platform to you. You know, what are you trying to do? You know, I think the private-public partnerships, there is not enough that is happening in the United States. You know, I think if we marry them together, you know, we can be far more effective in terms of addressing the needs of the people and applying that people-centric policies from our congressional and elected leaders. You know, this is the imperative I think we have. You know, we need to really explore that. And also, not to go on a tangent here, but when you look at all the infrastructure investment that is needed, and this is part of our COVID-19 policy, you know, we talk about investing hugely in infrastructure because this is the right time. It's not the time to be fearful. It's the time to be fearless and bold and make some bold choices for America. Mm-hmm. And how do you do that, right? I mean, we have limited dollars in the public sector, but you know, companies in America are flush with money. How about collaborating, you know, having them make that investment, and perhaps they have some share in terms of how they operate that. But this is the public-private partnership that we need to happen. You look at the housing problem we have here, and you know, all the companies here, the tech companies, are benefiting out of what we have here. You know, we have something very special here in Silicon Valley, right? Mm-hmm. But I don't think so. They are contributing to it enough. So what about having the Googles of the world build out housing for their employees right on campus, and also creating affordable housing units for our police officers, for our firefighters, for our teachers? You know, I think we need to create a model where our tech companies or the corporate America is willing to invest into infrastructure, and countries of the world are actually beating America in this infrastructure game. I mean, they are rolling out like some of the cutting edge transportation systems, and here we are stuck in the world. I mean, the last innovation that happened here is basically, if you go back, it was probably the freeway system. You know, I mean, that's it. We haven't done anything more than that, which is really sad for a country like America. We need to do a lot more.
Mm-hmm. Okay, I don't necessarily disagree with you, but I've argued with a lot of very far left people, so I'm going to give you some of the common counter arguments that I hear from far left people. I'm just curious what your response is. So when you talk about the federal government collaborating with the private sector for things like tech related purposes, while that might seem positive, you know, other people would be quick to point out, for instance, things like the military-industrial complex, how we've outsourced a lot of our military stuff to companies like Boeing or Lockheed Martin, or, you know, the way that we've taken prisons and we've privatized a lot of that and created perverse incentives as a result, or even more related to electioneering, the shadow app in Iowa that everybody lost their minds over when the Iowa caucus tracking was so messed up. For people that would point out that collaborating with private companies as the federal government for things like creating programs for like tax purposes, like the second something comes up where people feel like, you know, Amazon gets criticized for their tax filings all the time, how do you prevent people from not seeing there being some perverse incentive there or some unholy union of corporation and state in an era where, you know, even people like yourself are saying like we shouldn't take so much lobbyist money, but we are going to work directly with Google to like craft programs to help people get money from the federal government. Like how do you deal with what seems like a misproper union between private and public there?
Yep. Mm-hmm. So, you know, I think I once again have a very simple answer.
Yeah.
And so I reference the incumbent from our district, Congresswoman Anna Eshoo, who I love and respect her a lot for her 28 years of service. Mm-hmm. But, you know, she's the chair of the House Health Subcommittee. Mm-hmm. And, you know, she deals with healthcare issues all the time. And then she's the number one recipient of pharma money in United States Congress. You know, is the fox guarding the hen house? And this is what we need to prevent, right? So when it's a very simple approach, you know, we shouldn't allow companies that would have an investment into their own agenda to run a specific piece of the public sector. Simple as that, right? So what does that mean? I think what we are talking about is, you know, very specific areas of the public sector, there needs to be a collaboration with the private sector. And I'll just look at the software industry, for example. Mm-hmm. So the stimulus package payouts, you know, it's very easy to get one of the software firms from here. And it doesn't need to be a mega company. You know, you could work with even a startup because it's not that complicated. And you have them make and build those types of offerings. So I think we cannot go overboard with terms of everything. And that's why we have to pick and choose where the collaboration with the public and private sector would happen. So it's not like you can apply it across the board. You have to pick and choose.
Gotcha. Okay. Something that's kind of related to these issues as well. We talked earlier about how Silicon Valley is innovating and how America has a pretty unique place on top of the world insofar as like our tech innovations go. How would you address people that say that rather than being incredibly innovative, we've kind of reached the stage where we just have these monolithic, mega, ultra huge corporations that are just kind of growing and growing and aren't necessarily as involved with like innovating, you know, like new technologies or softwares anymore. So I'm talking about like Amazon, Facebook, Google. Is there any way that you would address that? Would you agree that companies like Google or Amazon need to be broken up or more restricted in some ways? Or do you continue to let them do what they're going to do and regulate them other ways? Or how do you address that?
Yeah, so, you know, I think I always look at Stephen in terms of what problem are we trying to address, you know. Mm-hmm. So when I look at the privacy issues that were exposed with Facebook and Cambridge Analytica, mm-hmm. you know, I was a bystander and watching it, and I could tell clearly that Facebook had a lot of data. And I used to wonder how it would play out. So it behooves our elected leaders to roll out policies that would protect the American people, you know. Mm-hmm. And this should have happened, you know, many, many years before we even discovered what happened with Cambridge Analytica, you know. Mm-hmm. So that is my take on that in terms of how we can address these types of challenges. I'm sorry, could you repeat the question one more time? No.
I'm curious if you would plan to disrupt like how large a company like Google or Amazon or Facebook is. Like, do you think these companies need to be like broken up, or do you think that they're fine operating as is, kind of?
Yeah, so, you know, I think I go back to, you know, what is the problem that we're looking to solve? So mm-hmm. when you look at the innovation spectrum, you know, I do agree with you, Stephen, that many companies have stopped innovating. When you look at the pharma industry, you know, they have one big break. And then after that, you know, I've seen a consistent pattern that they are unable to roll out that next magical drug. And what they end up doing is they go out and ingest different startups to increase their revenue stream, you know. And so this is an operating model that has worked for even companies like IBM, Cisco, or Gilead's of the world, right? So this has become an established practice. And why is it playing out? Because they are playing to the gallery, to the shareholders, and they are sort of appealing to them. Nothing wrong with that. You know, I think there are startups that will emerge. So what really needs to happen is what I've seen Cisco do very often. You know, they would actually, you know, when I was at Cisco, I would see these companies coming in startups, and they would be pitching, you know, what their idea and the plan that they put together, and Cisco would fund them. Cisco would fund them. They would have a stake in those companies. And then, you know, if things worked out well, they would ingest it. It actually works out really well, Stephen, if you look at it, because now, you know, these hungry startups that are looking for a strong foundation to succeed are provided that stimulus package that they need to get things going. And after a year or 2 years, you know, then the verdict is up in the air in terms of whether they succeeded in that effort or not. So I think the model that we have here is playing out quite well. Mm-hmm. And so to summarize, you know, if there are issues that are affecting the people, you know, for me, you know, there's absolutely no need to go out and try to change policies with respect to tech or with respect to Silicon Valley. But what I will be pretty open about is when the people issues are being trampled upon, when, for example, people's privacies or, you know, people are not being, they are being challenged with respect to some of their core issues, that's when we need to step up and apply a policy. It's very simple. Because I think we should have created a policy on privacy many, many years back. You look at GDPR in Europe that is addressing that. You know, what happens is, you know, I've gotten like so many mailers from like doctors, oh, we lost your laptop and your data was compromised. Perhaps your social security number is compromised and nothing else happens from that, you know. Mm-hmm. So I think we need to protect the people with simple policies like GDPR. California has rolled out something now, but the rest of America is still trying to catch up. So there is significant effort that needs to be applied in there.
Yeah. Yeah. I remember a lot of people from the tech world were really irritated about the GDPR. And then I run a website myself where we store user data. So even for us, we were kind of making fun of it. But after it went out, it's actually kind of nice that I can query like a website's database and be like, hey, what information do you have about me? Or like, hey, I haven't used your site in 2 years. Delete your stuff. I don't want there to be a password leak, you know, 2 decades from now. And somehow somebody has like my, you know, my email and my real name and my address. So in actuality, I think a lot of the GDPR stuff was pretty positive.
I agree.
Yeah. Moving on. Okay. So moving on from tech stuff, totally different subject area. Something else that I talk about a lot is, taking money from like PACs or taking money from like larger donor organizations. In a large or in like the broader picture, nobody wants to take corporate money. Like, I'm sure everybody would like to be Bernie Sanders, where you get, you know, all the money that you need from, you know, individual donors. But if you're looking at running competitive elections where you're going to be outspent, you know, 5-1, 10-1 by somebody that is taking either PACs or super PACs or corporate donors, and you're not, do you think that it's worth it to compromise there and say, well, maybe we should, if it comes down to winning or losing elections or seats in Congress? Or how do you address that?
So, Stephen, simply stated, for me, it has always been about ethical integrity. And I look at politics and need to get the right type of leaders elected. And when people ask me, you know, what specific criteria do you have with looking at elected leaders, who are you going to support? I say number one is ethical integrity, and then 2-10, the same exact thing, because this is the most important thing. And we are setting a clear messaging when we say that we will reject PAC money and special interest group money. And to some extent, Stephen, it's not about winning and losing, but changing the culture of America, because we as elected leaders are setting the messaging with respect to the young students who are watching us operate in the world. You look at the current summer program that we have. You know, we have a summer fellowship, which is modeled after President Obama's fellowship program. And we have a few hundred college and high school students that have joined us. And what I want to do is to be the best example for them. So when I interview them, when we interview them, they are basically telling us that, look, the fact that you don't take any PAC money, the fact that you stand for Medicare for All, the fact that you do this is the reason why I'm joining your team. It's a phenomenal story. We need to shift the story. And it's people like me, the new brand of leaders who are looking to change politics, need to establish that, because it's very, very important. And why is it important? Because this is the fundamental component of what is wrong with American politics. So here is the story, right? A brand new congressional leader, apparently in the very first day in Washington, was taken by a senior member of the Senate to a bunch of lobbyists for a lunch meeting on the very first day in Washington. This is sad. This is really sad. You know, we have to shift that story. And if you look at someone like me, we believe you have a very strong story of winning this particular race, because we know how to define the message and how to run a great grassroots campaign. It's not about the money. I mean, you know, you look at elections that have played out in the past. People might have spent so much money, but they didn't end up winning, because it's all we talk about. It simply stated that how you win an election is by engaging with every voter from multiple channels with a strong, concise, precise messaging. That's how you win election. It's not about the money. It's about how you run a campaign. And that's why, you know, money should not be part of the equation. Yes, you need basic amount of money. So when you look at us, you know, when we started running, people asked me, how much money do you need? And I looked at prior elections and I said, maybe I need so much. But, you know, we have run our campaigns at a fraction of what was spent in previous campaigns. And because we understand how to run a strong grassroots campaign. So that's the key for success.
Okay. Okay. So I'm going to push you a little bit on this, because this is, in my opinion, I think is a really important issue. So something that I'm curious about, or something that I guess kind of bothers me, is that, as I said before, I think everybody's dream is we don't take any corporate or PAC money, which would be nice, because then you'd feel like your politicians are representing the actual voters and not the companies that, you know, are sponsoring their stay in Congress, basically. I guess the only thing that I kind of worry about, or that I wonder, is that I think it's really good for you. You want a primary, like a Democratic candidate, in a very, very, very blue district. One thing that I worry about is when people make it into Congress from relatively safe districts, pressuring Democrats that are in very vulnerable districts, that are highly competitive, that sometimes have hundreds of thousands or over $1 million spent across some of these Senate or congressional campaigns. Do you ever worry about, or do you ever think it might be damaging, that you could lose seats in a competitive district because you're pressuring people so much away from taking, whether it's corporate or lobbyist or super PAC money, in order to run their races? Do you think sometimes it might be better to lose on principle than to win on a compromise? That's a hard one. Sorry. It's been a big issue that's come up these past election cycles. Yeah.
Yeah. And, you know, so I think it depends on the lens with which we view the world. And I do believe I try to operate. For me, the principles are a lot more important than anything else. And in fact, you know, it's a true story, because there was a very simple issue playing out in our community where there was a hillside development being planned. And, you know, there was a lot of, it became very controversial. And so I texted to my buddy, we were chatting, and I said, look, you know, when it comes to issues like these, you know, I have pledged to serve our people, our constitution, our American flag. You know, this is the pledge I've taken. And I need to make sure that I'm doing justice to that. And even if I have to give up my life, you know, I think that is okay. But I need to step up and do the right thing, because there are so many millions of Americans who have done so much more. They have given up their life for this country. And this is something very simple. You know, it's a project, and we have to make sure that we make the right choices. So to answer your question, Stephen, it's I would much rather define a new brand of politics, because the very future of America is at stake. It's not about me winning or losing, but standing tall for what we stand for, because, you know, that's really what matters. I mean, we still remember Dr. King. We still remember Mahatma Gandhi for many decades after they are gone. And there is a reason why. And I think that is what we need to teach our children. You know, if my kids are going to learn these types of principled behavior, my job is done. You know, I'll be pretty happy. Doesn't matter whether you win or lose. And to some extent, so going back to answer your question, you know, I think there will be a amount of pressure, but I still believe that politics is not a money game. You know, you have to, there are different ways to approach it. And Congresswoman Anna Eshoo has probably 100 times more money than me. But what she will never, ever compete on is the grassroots movement that we have built. And that's the reason why we're going to win. So we are so confident and pumped up, Stephen, mm-hmm. that this race is going to belong to us, because we are going by that first principle of defining a strong message and engaging with every voter. I mean, look at the pandemic, right? What we did was we stopped a campaign, and people were like, oh my God, Rishi, what's going to happen to you? We stopped the campaign. I said, I have no idea. Stop the campaign, because this is the time America needs help. We figured out that seniors were quarantined at home. Mm-hmm. We said, let's call them. I started calling the seniors. And you know what we have done so far in the last about 3 months? We have called about 45,000 seniors, asking them, do you need groceries? Do you need medication? What help do you need? Mm-hmm. Somebody said, I've been married to my wife since I was 12 years old, and she's in a very fragile condition. I need this very special brand of coffee from Pete's. My wife went and picked it up, and she dropped it off. I mean, this is where we all need to help our neighbors out. We were building masks. We engaged on so many fronts, talking about stimulus package or talking about college admission or even providing advice to people in terms of, you know, how they can find a job in this economy. This is what is more important than winning or losing. You know, we need to be out there helping. And this is what will create America so much more stronger compared to the direction we are heading into.
Mm-hmm. Speaking more specifically to that, referring to calling out seniors and everything. So I understand that you were involved in launching the neighborhood pandemic preparedness team. Do you want to talk a little bit about that initiative and how stuff like that plays into our general like COVID-19 response and everything?
Yes. So, you know, essentially part of the work, excuse me, that I'd done in our community was crime, burglaries. You know, we are a fairly affluent community, mm-hmm. and there were burglaries happening around us, which created a lot of angst, one too many. And so when I started working on my effort, you know, some of my colleagues pointed out that, hey, Rishi, you'll drop the price of real estate in Saratoga by taking on crime. But, you know, when I see a problem, I have to step up. So long story short, we had over 100 neighborhood meetings. We put together a framework of a repeatable cookie cutter process of rolling out neighborhood watch programs. Mm-hmm. So before we got started, we had three. And by the time I was done, in about a year's time, we had over 50 neighborhood watch programs, and we had dropped burglaries by 47%.
Can you, I'm sorry, just so that I understand, or I don't know if you misspoke or I misheard you. When you say that'll drop the price, what is it, or how does that make sense? Less burglaries would drop the price?
When you talk about crime, uh-huh. then people will say, oh, there's crime in the city. We will not buy real estate in the city.
Oh, so by addressing it, you make people aware of it, which makes people less likely to, okay, gotcha, I understand, okay. And then, so you move from three to, you said 15, like neighborhood watch initiatives or whatever?
Three to 50. And today we have over 70, right?
I mean, this 70, has, 50, okay.
Yeah, it has really caught fire. And we dropped burglaries by 47%, more than any other Silicon Valley city. Mm-hmm. And so what we did was that program was already tried and tested. We knew how to do that. It was all about empowering neighbors. We called it the neighbors to connect, communicate, and collaborate. And this really led to what we saw in the final outcome. So we said, let's see how we can empower neighbors across these different cities. So we announced this program, and today we have a few hundred volunteers. So when seniors are when we are calling them and saying, okay, how can we help? And every day we are getting quite a few requests, people saying, I need this, I need that, how can you help us? And we figured out a volunteer who lives, so we call it a war room, a pandemic war room, which is actually managed by one of our college students. Mm-hmm. And essentially when they find an opportunity, someone who needs help, then we figure out a volunteer. We connect the volunteer with the senior, and this is how we go out and fulfill the request. And it's a great model that worked out really well. We put out a request to make the PPEs were a huge handicap. Mm-hmm. And we started making masks. Our high school interns, they have learned how to sew and they are building masks. So empowering neighbors, empowering a community, and showing them a path to neighbors helping neighbors is a great way to get out of a crisis like this.
Earlier, I guess when we were talking about like the neighborhood watch programs, I mean, obviously one of the national narratives right now, the national narrative right now, is centered around police forces that exist around the country. There have been a variety of approaches to this, from Trump, who seems to want to use the military to terrorize everybody, all the way to people saying that there are a set of reforms that we can enact to help police departments, all the way to people that are saying we need to abolish police departments entirely, and then they have different capacities for how they want people to operate after that. Do you, broadly speaking, like, where is your stance on, like, abolish the police or the Campaign 8 reforms or whatever, or the, I think it was Campaign Zero is something that Obama referenced in terms of police reforms. Where do you stand at in terms of reforming the police in the United States? Or what do you think needs to be done to bring them more in line with how we would want police to operate in our communities?
So I truly believe, Stephen, that Campaign Zero is the right approach with limiting police interventions, mm-hmm. Improving community interactions, and ensuring accountability. You know, accountability has been denied to the Black people for centuries, and it is crucial that we impose legislative confirmation that accountability is ensured. Mm-hmm. We should also consider things like citizens' task force and independent investigations to ensure accountability in the system. So we also need to consider how we want to abolish legislative police protections. I think it's about time we evaluated that and came up with a better model. These are shifts that need to happen given what happened with George Floyd. And I can definitely see movement in that direction now.
Okay. Do you think that the people that are calling for the hashtag abolish the police completely, do you think those people kind of are moving a little bit too far? Or?
Yes, that question came up in our youth town hall just yesterday. And somebody mm-hmm. asked me, Rishi, what about stopping the funding for your sheriff services? You know, we are a minimal service city. And so we get we have the Santa Clara County Sheriff Department that provides us the safety and security that we need for our city. Mm-hmm. It doesn't make sense because, you know, we need the patrolling, we need presence here because, you know, when you look at burglaries that happen, it went almost 100%, 100% jump over like 4 or 5 years for a variety of different reasons. So I think defunding the police is probably not the way, but there are other ways to do it, to work on this problem. For example, we can redirect funds. You know, we should propose a policy of training officers in a new, unique way. For example, officers get 58 hours of shooting training, gun training, and they get only 8 hours for de-escalation. You know, we have to reprioritize these dollars. Mm-hmm. We also should engage other social workers because, you know, I mean, our police officers are putting themselves in the harm's way and their nerves are always frayed. Let's take it. Let's believe it. I mean, just when they pull over somebody on the side of the road, that will tend to increase your stress level because you never know what's going to happen. So we need to engage different other mechanisms to ensure that that our police officers are only doing what they specialize in, mm-hmm. and we bring in other specialists. So that's how we have to look at the funding allocation in different areas to address this type of challenge. A root cause analysis is needed. You know, we cannot have a knee-jerk reaction and approaching it from that standpoint. You know? So there are many more things that can be done.
Yeah, I definitely agree. That was part of the Campaign Zero project that I was reading about. It's kind of crazy that police are expected to stand in for literally everything. Domestic abuse, you know, intervention, police come in. Mental health crises, the police come in. Somebody's committing it could be suicidal, the police come in. You know, a dog runs away from a house, the police. Yeah, it seems like we call the police for literally everything. And most of these people have even the bare minimum training to just be police, let alone to be crisis interventionalists, animal handlers, mental health, you know, counselor. Yeah, it was kind of crazy for sure. I don't disagree with that at all. I guess overall, what do you think is going to change in American politics going forward from the pretty unbelievable past, like, 3 to 6 months we've had, with the two big ones being now we've had what seem to be historic riots in the United States. Are historic riots in the United States. I don't know how else to say it. And then with the coronavirus stuff, you know, it's been like 100 years since we've ever seen, an epidemic or a pandemic spread like this. What do you think is going to change going forward in American politics? And what do you think you as a legislator would need to be ready to respond to in order to adapt to kind of like the newer post-COVID-19, post-George Floyd riot world?
So, I think we have a little bit of a doom and gloom scenario playing out right now with our economy and all the challenges. You know, we haven't seen anything yet because, you know, we are still sort of sheltered in place. And when finally we sort of normalcy happens, mm-hmm. and we don't know when that will happen. You know, I mean, this is something unprecedented that we have never quite seen. Mm-hmm. So it'll play out for many months and many years now, you know. And what will clearly be apparent to people is that we need to make some tough choices. You know, we need to make some tough choices. And let's give you an example of that, right? So I have been in favor of Medicare for All. Mm-hmm. And I was a Bernie Sanders delegate in 2016. And I really believe in the ideologies of the man, even though I'm a little bit of a centrist with respect to some of the other policies. But, I truly value what Bernie did in terms of defining a Medicare for All system. You know, right now we have, 118 congressmen who have signed up for 1384, HR 1384, that probably never had happened before. So when I would talk to our Silicon Valley community here, they would tell me, Rishi, you know, I don't know why you're supporting Medicare for All. Please leave my private option alone. You know, I really love my healthcare provider, mm-hmm. and I do not want to ever lose them, right? So that's how they would approach it. But now what has happened is there are many spouses, both the spouses have lost their job in this economy and they are struggling. You know, they have a COBRA plan, which is very finite. It provides them some sort of a coverage.
Really expensive too, in my experience. COBRA plans usually can cost quite a bit too. Oh, yeah.
Exactly. Yep. So now the reality is setting in that, oh my God, what happens if I don't have a job? Mm-hmm. And then, you know, the lens through which they view the world is shifting now, because now they are wearing somebody else's shoe, which they never thought they would have to. Mm-hmm. And this is how America is shifting. You know, I think there are new realizations happening. For example, social net. You know, who would have thought that America would give out your $1,200 checks to everybody, right? Mm-hmm. And Bernie Sanders is talking about giving it out for a much longer period. And, you know, when I hear that, yes, because this will play out for many, many months or perhaps years now. You know, who knows how this will play out and what will happen when people don't have food on the table and they are struggling with some basic needs of mankind, you know, and how do you deal with that, right? Mm-hmm. So it's a new world that is playing out and there'll be new realizations. And like I said, it is going to be very apparent that it's the pandemic, the social unrest, which is highlighting to Americans that we need to make some proper choices. And the time is now, it's not tomorrow. And it should have happened yesterday, but we haven't done that. But the time is right now. Let's go out and make those proper choices. Let's elect the right type of elected leaders and make those choices to ensure that we are building a better economy, a better future for every American, which includes bridging that divide between the haves and the have-nots. You know, that gap has grown and grown and grown, and it has gotten wider, and it will create in the future, like Bernie Sanders talks about, you know, it's a revolution waiting to happen, because if we don't address it now, this will create a lot of unrest. And that realization is clicking into people's heads based upon what coronavirus has exposed to us, you know. Mm-hmm.
If you were to be in Congress, or if you had kind of enact like a dream legislation, what are like one or two huge policies, or what are like the one or two biggest things, if you could just snap your fingers and these were done, would you enact to kind of like change where America is or where America could be going in the future?
So I think let's look at it from the COVID-19 world, because mm-hmm. we had lots of policy ideas before the primaries. And now we are looking at everything from the challenges of coronavirus. And one of the things we talk about is infrastructure investment. You know, we haven't quite done enough of that. We need to invest into transportation systems. You know, we need to create zero greenhouse gas public transportation systems and prevent the energy burn that is happening in every urban economy of the United States. Mm-hmm. We need to create that, because we talk about, you know, the climate change and all that, but we need to make some hard choices right now. This is the time where we need to invest in that. So that will be what we have talked about is a tunnel-based transportation system. Because what's going on in Silicon Valley is there are people leaving. In 2015, we had 24,000 people a net coming into Silicon Valley. And then in 2017, we are down to like 3,000 people net leaving Silicon Valley a year. Mm-hmm. So, you know, we are losing people and we have to address the quality of life challenges here. So this is infrastructure investment is going to be very, very important to me. Mm-hmm. Then when you look at healthcare, you know, we obviously are talking about Medicare for all, but let's peel the onion just slightly what happened with the economy. Our economy crashed. We went down to our knees because we said everybody should be sheltered in place. But what if we had an electronic medical record platform that President Obama tried to roll out many years back? You know, yeah. I don't think it went anywhere. But if you are able to pool this data and make it secure, you know, it has to be secure. It shouldn't be misused. But if you are able to create that EMR system and we are able to apply healthcare analytics and we figure out that here is the segment of the population that is more at risk with respect to this virus, mm-hmm. which would be a combination of experiments, but also software and, you know, applying AI and ML algorithms to understand, you know, how this virus would play out. And now you are able to figure out, you know, which segment of the population is at risk. You stay at home, the rest of the folks can go about. And this is how we can address the needs of the future. Let's call it a biowarfare, because this truly exposed us what would likely happen, because the traditional warfare is going to fade away. You know, it's going to be a warfare about economy. And this is what America needs to do. So this will be very near and dear to me to look at policies from a tech standpoint to make, to bolster our healthcare offering to ensure that we will address these types of threats of the future. You know, this is the investment that is needed with healthcare. Mm-hmm. And then when you look at supply chain, we need to bring manufacturing back. You know, we talk about self-reliant American economy because it's actually a national defense issue. You know, you look at the generic drugs, most of them come from China. Mm-hmm. You look at drugs that are manufactured by United States, 80% of these drugs rely upon raw material from China. So this is a significant source of risk for us. And we need to address that. You know, I think we have been talking about it, but we haven't really shifted in that direction yet. And these are the urgent issues of our times. And we need to make sure we address that.
Sure. Okay. I got one more okay. This is a hard one too. I'm sorry for these, but you mentioned people leaving Silicon Valley. So how do you balance so you're running for the federal House of Representatives to represent the entirety of the United States. But obviously you're coming from a particular district in California that is going to be overrepresented for tech jobs. So one of the key parts of what you want to do with your campaign is make it so that tech is more competitive around the United States so that, like, maybe it's not inconceivable that a tech startup wants to start in Louisiana instead of, say, California or Texas or Washington. How do you, now, if you do this, if this went perfectly in an ideal world, you are going to be losing people from Silicon Valley that are going to be moving to other less expensive places, right? If West Virginia was competitive for tech, it's going to be way cheaper to open a business there than it would be obviously in Silicon Valley. How do you address the concerns of your constituents, you know, from California that are like, hey, like these tech programs, I guess are cool for the country, but now we're starting to bleed talent. We have to pay more. We have to be more competitive in what we offer for compensation. Like, you know, this sucks for us. How do you balance their concerns with the wider concerns for the country?
You know, I think, Stephen, I'm not trying to be a little cocky here.
Yeah, sure.
Silicon Valley will never, ever lose what we have going here. You know, I mean, we'll never, I don't think so, will be superseded by any other city or any other country mm-hmm. because we have something magical going here, which starts from the best of talents, not only arriving here from all over America, but also from the world. But I'll tell you why we will not lose, because we need to create a new vision for Silicon Valley. You know, the problem is we do not have affordable housing anymore. So young engineers, as soon as they have their first child or they get married, they're looking at, okay, how do I buy a house? So do I buy a house for $2.5 million over here? Or can I go buy a house or home for $400,000 in Austin, Texas?
Or so Portland, Oregon or something, yeah.
Exactly. You know, they are leaving. They are leaving Silicon Valley. But this is the opportunity that we have right now. So we talk about a mega Silicon Valley vision. So there's the Northern California mega region comprised of 21 counties. Mm-hmm. And what my vision plan is to build and connect these 21 counties with high-speed transportation, a tunnel-based system, you know, a zero greenhouse gas, economically, environmentally friendly And you have to provide housing opportunities in other far-flung areas. So, and now we have built out a mega Silicon Valley, which will actually quadruple over time. I mean, the economy will skyrocket. Why? Because when a young engineer buys a home in Stockton and they're commuting to San Jose in 15 minutes from Stockton, you know, when they look at doing a startup, they will actually go out and put their office right there in Stockton. So this is how we can seed right here in California. We can build out a much larger economy. Now, what we have going here is cutting edge technology. You know, when we look at states, it will take them. Yes, there is a possibility they might catch up, just like Austin did, Boston and Seattle for that matter. But nobody calls them a Silicon Valley. You know, we have our own unique secret sauce. And as long as we can create a better plan, a better vision for the future, which will allow us to keep people here, build out a mega Silicon Valley economy, I think we'll be in a good shape.
Okay, cool. If you ever get the public transit working in San Francisco, you need to bring that down here to LA as well. Jeez. Yeah. All right. Well, I mean, I think those were most of the major issues that I hit on. Where, if you could direct people to like one or two areas, like what do you want people to visit if they want to support your campaign in some way, whether it's campaign contributions or, you know, helping you guys out with volunteering or canvassing? Yeah, where would you like people to go to find you guys?
Yes. So, you know, we do have quite a few grassroots volunteers. But if you are here in Silicon Valley, I invite you to join the team. Go to the homepage and fill up the form, and we'll invite you for a meeting. And but really what we need is we need funds, because in the post-coronavirus world, you know, funds are going to be a big challenge for someone like me. And we are obviously rejecting all PAC and special interest group money. And we do have a clear story in terms of how we're going to win this race. So I invite you to make a campaign contribution today at rishikumar.com and just search for Rishi, R-I-S-H-I, United States Congress. You will find my website, and please make a campaign contribution. Any and all campaign contribution will be great for us. And this is a grassroots movement. We are there for the people, and we're relying upon people power to get us through to the next level. And I guarantee you this, and what I have made a personal assurance is, when a crisis like this plays out, just like how we are calling seniors, we are holding town hall meetings, obviously, but we're reaching out to residents of our district one-on-one and asking them, how can we help? That's the diligence of public service that we will bring, and we'll be solving a lot of problems, not only here for Silicon Valley, we'll also be solving problems for the United States in terms of education, in terms of infrastructure, in terms of how we are looking at engaging a public-private sector together to solve the big challenges. So, Stephen, it's going to be an exciting story, and invite your viewers to participate and help us out. I would truly appreciate that.
Yeah, okay, cool. Yeah, I've got your site linked in the chat. I'm sure it'll be linked on the YouTube video, rishikumar.com. I appreciate you for being here today. Thanks a lot. Do you have any final words or anything you want to say before we take off?
I really thank you for the opportunity, and I appreciate any and all campaign contributions. Thank you.
All right, thanks a lot. Have a good day.
You too. Bye-bye.
This was the, we're done with it now, though. We're done. The riots are done. The protests are done. They're not, there's no more talking now. This was the most that happened.